up in month. And on the third Thursday, you can always count on something happening. And we're having from 6 to 8 tomorrow night a pick a painting improv with our voice theater troupe. So you can come, and if you want to, you can just point out a painting, and then we'll do an improv around that painting. So if you ever want to experience paintings in a little bit of a different way, come tomorrow night. We also have book club tomorrow night from 6 to 7:30, and we're discussing Lab Girl. And we have sunset yoga from 6:30 to 7:30. So you can just pick whatever sounds interesting to you tomorrow night. And Friday, March 16th, we're having a lecture and a book signing by Jenny Rose Carey. She's the author of Glorious Shade. Many of us in Midtown and East Memphis have shade, and that's all. And so if you want to learn about plants in it, well, then come to that lecture on the 16th. And on March 21st, our lunch and learn is going to be New Miniature and Standard Daffodils by Larry Force. But today, of course, we have Kevin Sharp, and I have to really, really commend Kevin, because the lunch and learn that was originally scheduled today, a couple of weeks ago, fell through. We are going to reschedule it as a talk at 2, though. And so I thought, now who would people really want to see? And of course, it is Kevin Sharp. And he was very gracious in agreeing to, on very short notice, do this talk for me. And so I really appreciate it, and everyone here appreciate it.
But you know, the time just gets away from you. You know, of a sudden it goes quickly, and it turns out there are so many images. I mean, I wanted something kind of general that I could, you know, that I could kind of speak to, where no one would think I was too much of a knucklehead and be running a public garden. But like I said, the time just got away from me, and there was just so, it's such a vast subject, and artists have been painting gardens forever. I mean, you know, it kind of starts, it kind of starts right here, you know? This is Lucas Cranach the Elder, and Lucas Cranach the Younger also painted the same subject, and artists have painted that subject, you know, many, many times before the Cranachs figured it out. I mean, it's one of the most common themes. And so it's little wonder that it becomes such a revered subject, especially in our moment in the 19th century. And so what I learned before I started really kind of plunged into this topic is that we had a group of master gardeners here this morning, and we invited them, the garden staff invited them to come to this talk after their program this morning. If you're a master gardener here for this talk, raise your hand, please. I see some right there. Well, great. Yeah, a round of applause. Because we're going to ask you to help. There's going to be any number of moments where I don't have any idea what I'm looking at apart from oil paint. And so we'll get through this together, all right? So, I mean, maybe it starts here, maybe it doesn't. The whole idea of garden building really takes hold in the 17th century and 18th century when they call physics gardens are built in Europe, which are for medicinal purposes, for growing the herbs that will go into the medicines that will probably eventually kill you. And then ornamental gardens begin to emerge as well. And then by the 18th century, when Fragonard is painting, you know, that what's called the swing, but also called the happy accident of the swing. More frequently, you can see the happy accident occurring this gentleman's position in relationship to the swinging woman. And I'm really not making that up. It's called the happy accident of the swing, right? So, and of course, said it, you know, for the kind of romantic subject we're looking at here, or the fact that it's in a burned place like the garden only makes a certain amount of sense. You know, in the 19th century, you know, gardening becomes something that's within reach of all of us in a way. You know, it becomes the kind of thing that even urban dwellers, and you might remember this little Daumier print from the Sense of Symbolism exhibition we did this past spring, where a little Parisian peasant has nailed together a bit of a window box, and he is trying very hard, even though he appears to have kind of a stopped up nose, to smell the whatever that plant is on his windowsill. And this was part of a series of prints that he made based on the five senses. And so this is one that represented the sense of smell. And of course, in every case, Daumier is such an ironist. In every case, the sense is being thwarted somehow. In this case, it's by, you know, hay fever or something like that. And then by the time we get into our moment, artists are fascinated by gardens, whether they're public gardens, like we're seeing here, Manet's painting of Music in the Tuileries from 1862, where a group of what would you call those men, Julie? Flaneurs? Yes, you would. And women are getting ready for a concert in a public garden. But you know, more often, well, I shouldn't say more often. I mean, artists paint in public gardens plenty, but they also have a tendency to move into the private realm, and that's the thing about that's the thing about gardens, that that becomes very, very interesting in a way. You know, I mean, painting itself before the 19th century, really the Impressionist Revolution, is thought of as a much more public endeavor, and the subjects tend to be more public. With the rise of Impressionism, there's a concurrent rise in a kind of intimate subjects that are more personal. And so in this very early work by Monet, the artist we probably associate most closely with the painting of gardens.
Agreed?
Yeah. We see something of a domestic scene. Now, you know, they could also be, we're not entirely certain where Monet is in this moment. We know that he's in Saint-Adresse, up on the Normandy coast. He's just a little bit up the coast from Le Havre, which is where he's from. His aunt owns a home in Saint-Adresse, but we know that her home doesn't actually have a view of the sea. So it probably wasn't there. It could be at a sailing club, because there's a lot of sailing there, but there's also, the best guess is that flag is the flag of the sailing club. This flag, of course, is the French flag. This is Monet's bond. We know that. We know kind of a lot about this painting. It's in the Met, because Monet wound up keeping it for a number of years. He paints it in 1867, and he shows it in the Fourth Impressionist Exhibition in 1879, which is a little bit unusual. It's not particularly, you know, in that day and age, you make the painting, you want that painting to, well, in any age, you make the painting, you want that painting out the door, and he hung onto it for a long time, and he called it his Chinese paintings with flags. Now, part of the reason, any idea why he would call it the Chinese painting with flags? We know why he called it with flags, because it's flags, but he called it the Chinese painting because it's based, the composition is based on a print that he owned by the Japanese artist Hokusai. And, you know, all things Asian at that time was still so relatively new that, you know, even someone who, like Monet, is not an idiot, couldn't always tell the difference between China and Japan. And so, but you know, unfortunately, he wrote it down, the letter was saved, and so we know what he called it. This is, I mean, it looks like a scene of a relative domestic harmony. We're surrounded by nasturtiums down here, I think. And, you know, what are these tall things? Gladiolas, good job. And, you know, these are probably some kind of plant life. Just a guess. If I'm totally wrong, just tell me. It looks like a scene, and this is actually a cousin, Sophie LaCaille. That's her daughter, and that's Sophie's husband. And so it's just this little family grouping, and it looks fairly, you know, fairly cheerful, fairly pleasant, a nice sunny day, except that they're all furious at Monet in this moment, because Monet's got a girlfriend, and nobody likes the girlfriend. The girlfriend is Camille, he'll wind up marrying her. She'll have two sons, they'll have two sons together, but she's not of a proper station, okay, to marry into the illustrious Monet family. And little do they know that Monet's going to take that spot way down. But the good news is it'll come way back up too, you know, but at that point they're just going to live it. And Monet in this painting is basically trying to make nice. And he's doing a pretty good job, I say. You know, by this time, 6 years later, in 1873, he's moved to the village of Argenteuil, which is just northwest of Paris, maybe 10 miles, something like that. It's actually kind of a southern suburb now, but it was a separate city in the 18th 1970s, and one with very good train access. So, I mean, in a sense, he was a suburb then as well, and Monet would hop on the train. He lived out here, you know, in this lovely sort of suburban community, but he had easy access to the train. And his studio was actually in Paris, so he'd take that train, you know, maybe a short, you know, half-hour commute into the Gare de Lazare, which he also painted frequently, and work in a Paris studio, do his business, try to find his dealer, Paul Durand-Ruel, try to get Paul Durand-Ruel to maybe buy a painting or two, not always successfully. And on the weekends, or, you know, in the evenings, he could set his easel out in his yard and paint what I believe are probably dahlias here. Agree? Disagree? Just a guess. We have a pretty good idea that they are now. And so even though this guy is broke most of the time and barely selling work, he's got a really lovely home that he's rented from a friend of Edward Manet, who we saw who painted the music in the Tuileries. And so, I mean, he's living a very hand-to-mouth existence. And, you know, down at the lower left is his son Michel. That's probably Camille in the background, and Camille's hat. His hat is here in the tree. I'm guessing these are maybe white geraniums. I don't know. Anybody got any ideas? Shout them out if you do. Norma, come on. I've actually got a garden staff member in here. So, and Deborah as well. And there's Kim Rucker back there. So, what do you think? Any ideas?
Lots.
Baby. And what do you think these are back here in the background? It's really hard to tell. I mean, you know, for a gardener like Monet, by this time, by 1873, Monet is about as interested in gardening as he is in painting. Now, gardening doesn't pay the bills, painting does, but he really cannot quite get enough of it. And and of course, you know, ultimately, now we're fast forwarding, you know, into the 1890s. There's this period in the 1880s where he's painting anything but gardens. I mean, he's trying to paint subjects that he thinks are more sellable. Plus, he's got this real interest in painting imagery in repeated patterns. So, you know, like think of the grain stacks, the haystacks that he paints over and over and over. Or he also does the same thing with poplar trees. He paints them over and over and over. And he does the same thing with Rouen Cathedral. And later he'll do the same thing with the Houses of Parliament in London and Waterloo Bridge. But he basically moves to Giverny in 1883. As we've discussed many times about Monet, I mean, you know, I think I've told you this story on more than one occasion, but we'll go through it real quick because it's useful to know. You know, so in 1873, you know, when he paints his painting, he's married to Camille, he has two little boys, he has one really good patron, a man named Ernest Hochaday. And Ernest Hochaday buys just about every other painting the man makes, but he buys so many paintings that he gets so interested in painting that he goes red. And he had a really good business. I can't quite remember what it was, but he loses his business. And so to thank Monet, you know, he moves his family, his wife and his six children, into Monet's house here in Argenteuil, which you can go back and see. So you can see that into this very house. And Monet and Camille eventually dies. Monet's wife gets sick and passes away, and so he becomes a widower. And all of this is happening in rather quick succession in the mid 1870s. And so Monet thanks his friend for bringing himself, his wife, and his six children into his house. He thanks him by marrying Alice Hochaday, Ernest's wife.
So. So, yeah. You know, I mean, one thing, I mean, the guy had, you know, I guess he had nothing to lose, because by that time, you know, Ernest didn't have any money, he's not buying paintings anyway. But there's always a chance he's going to recover, you know? But, and they didn't actually marry, because Ernest and Alice Hochaday never divorced. And so they just move in together, and, you know, they move into a series of houses, but it's just, you know, Monet goes from his kind of quiet garden lifestyle with his you know, his first wife and his two children to just a kind of cacophony. I mean, it's like he's in the house with eight people, and I mean, they move to another house in that toy, and he's no more in that house than he's out of there, and he's hanging on the Normandy coast again. You know, and Elise is now trying to take care of this household. By 1883, they finally went to Giverny. They rent the house that, you know, that is now quite famous. And but he still doesn't paint gardens. He buys the house in 1890, and he still has no, I mean, he's gardening, but he has no interest in painting the gardens. It's in this moment, 1991, 92, 93, that he's doing these serial paintings elsewhere. I think it has something to do with two things. One, this household full of kids that he's just got to get away from. And two, Americans had begun to find him. You know, he wasn't rich yet. He wasn't totally famous, but he was now, by 1890, he was a kind of a known quantity, and American painters were seeking him out. You know, he had to get away from them as well. And so, but then in 1893, he buys the house in Giverny in 1890. In 1893, he buys a little chunk of land, a pretty good sized chunk of land, that's just marsh, swamp land, really, right across the railroad tracks from his own property. And he petitions the city of Giverny for permission to divert a little streamlet into that land. And that's where he begins to build and then paint things like this. This is the Japanese bridge in his own garden at Giverny. It's still there. This is the painting that's in the National Gallery. This one is in the Princeton Art Museum. In 1899, he paints 12 paintings of this bridge. They're all each in their own way fabulous. And this bridge becomes kind of touchstone for him. And we're gonna come back to it later. And he creates these incredible water gardens. I mean, these willow trees. The willow trees were probably there already, because this was always a marshy area, but now it's a water garden, and we've got the nymphaeas growing, in the water. It's kind of hard to make out what all of this might be. Any guesses, garden staff? Well, water lilies down here, but these are something. Yeah, could be. Down through here. It doesn't really matter, but it's interesting to look at these things, because there was nobody who based their art on more careful and specific kinds of observation than Monet. You know, I mean, remember what Cézanne says about Monet. He says, Monet is just an eye. But what an eye. and it's really, really true. We'll get to more of that later. There's this, you know, here we're still in the garden, but we're in the garden that is closer to his own house. We know that this is Monet's house in Giverny. And I'm assuming these are iris, maybe bearded iris. You know, so he's developing a real passion for gardening. Besides, anybody been to Giverny? Raise your hand if you've been. Yeah. I mean, this is a big place. You know, I mean, this is not a little. I have no idea. I wonder how many acres it is. I wouldn't have any idea. I never thought to look it up. But it's big. It's big, especially when you include the water garden. And another view of his garden.
radius in the early 20th century? I mean, was that actively cultivated? Cam?
We're not getting a lot of participation from the garden stand. Well, maybe I'll have a talk with them later.
Yeah. Could be begonias. That's a real good, guess. And then, of course, you know, he paints his water lilies forever. They're nailed. And again, that Japanese bridge and these water lilies just become such a touchstone for him in his own thinking about his art, and also his thinking about his garden. And so, moving back in time, I mean, Monet is so incredibly associated with his garden that Renoir paints him, you know, as a painter, which he obviously is, but also a painter in a garden. I think, you know, it's usually suggested that, you know, that Monet's in his yard, and this what's arguably a large growth of massive dahlias, maybe again. But I think he could be in his neighbor's yard painting his own. Because I can't imagine Monet leaving this much of his own yard uncultivated. It just doesn't play that way. And so Renoir, we don't really associate him necessarily as a landscape painter, but in these early years with Monet, I mean, he gets the bug a little bit. And this is a painting of his backyard in Montmartre, in the garden of the Rue Courtauld. And again, I think we're looking at dahlias, I think. Looks like. Now this is where it gets tough. Okay, this is a painter that I tend to associate Gustav Kaiba. You know, he was trained as a marine engineer. I mean, he's an analytic kind of guy. You know, I lived with this painting for more than a decade when I was at the Art Institute, and this painting is just a machine. I mean, and this is his most famous work, Rainy Day in Paris, and it's not. You know, it looks a little rainier than the painting actually is, but that's okay. You know, and Kaiba would mind. The linear perspective in this work is just so brilliant. He messes with it, and believe me, you know, he's an engineer. He knows one-point perspective, you know, but he distorts it, so you get this feeling that there are multiple perspectives going on. This building isn't actually, it isn't actually, I mean, it should actually be a more dramatic recession into space. If that was true one-point perspective, instead it looks kicked up, and he kicks that building up to create a sense of disequilibrium, this kind of confusion from sometimes being in a city, you know, especially a city with so much action like Paris, can create. And then he does this other thing, this other really interesting thing, is that like every figure. I mean, these two look like they're right next to each other and there's nothing separating them, right? Well, it's not true, because there are these people in the background. He's constantly bringing you forward, pushing you back to these figures. Bringing you forward, pushing you back to these figures. Bringing you forward, pushing you back to these figures. And so there's this kicked-up perspective and then this push-pull of people in the city, and that's all by design. That's all to try to create this, like I said, this feeling of disequilibrium. The fact that you're seeing some man entering the composition, and he's like only half there. Yeah, it's just a brilliant painting. It really is. But you know, Kaibot was, unlike most of the Impressionists, incredibly wealthy, had tons of money, and his family made a lot of money. And then they made a lot more money during the Franco-Prussian War, selling textiles to the government for making tents and uniforms and all that stuff. He didn't, you know, if Ernest Hochaday wasn't buying Monet's paintings, Gustav Kaiba was. I mean, he basically kind of kept this culture of artists alive in the 1870s until they kind of got traction of their own in the 1880s. And you know, and he's a brilliant painter. I mean, I love to his paintings, but he sort of lost interest. And plus, he pays for the first two or three Impressionist exhibitions. He rents the space, you know, he does all whatever promotional thing that they did to get people to those shows. And so, I mean, we might not have any idea of what Impressionism is without Gustav Kaiwa. And then when he dies in 1894 or something like that, he tries to give his collection of Impressionist paintings to the French state. And you know what their response is? No thanks. Don't need it, don't want it. You know? And it's, by that time, I mean, Impressionism was becoming an international style. They had some influence. They could apply a bit of, the surviving artists could apply some pressure. And so the state reluctantly takes Kaiwa's collection. And it is, I mean, it's the cornerstone of the Musée d'Orsay today. So, so anyway, I mean, I show you this because not everybody remembers Gustav Kaiwa, and they, you know, and they should. And he's relevant to this conversation because at a certain point, you know, he has his house in the city and he paints urban subjects. He's kind of thought of as an urban impressionist, but he also has a country place in the village of Lierre. And he has a huge garden. And I have to believe that these are some kind of vegetables. Would you guess? You know, I would say that they're, you know, and look at how what a good painter he is. I mean, you know, this guy's what's he doing? He's watering whatever this is. And look at, you know, the ground is wet. I just love that. You know, and you know, I don't know what's under these little things, but you can maybe it's tomato plants. I don't think these are. I don't think, but maybe some tomato plants right underneath these buckets. So, you know, it is maybe a tender time in the spring. Any thoughts? Any guesses? I wondered if they were potatoes, but you know, we tend to kill, we mound potatoes. I mean, at least Americans do, and so do the French or the Irish. You know, the French may have some fancy potato that they don't do that, but I can't imagine that's the case. And then, but you can see what an impressive art this is. Is that Espaliego going on here on the walls? You know, I don't know what's under here, whether these are palm frames or what we're actually looking at here. This is probably, these are probably servants. This is not Gustav Kaiwa out there managing this kitchen garden. But it's an impressive looking garden. Not a weed in it. Yeah. And here's another Morgan Boyle sketch that he makes of it. And yeah, the other one as well. I know, I love Kaiwa. We don't own the Kaiwa, which is a crying shame. One, he dies fairly young too. He doesn't paint all that much because he doesn't have to. He never sells anything because, again, he doesn't really have to. So he's not all that productive, and some of his paintings are really, really rare. The Art Institute bought Rainy Day in Paris in the 1920s, and even then the family was still pretty prosperous and only sold it reluctantly to read the correspondence, but they did sell it, and it's one of the icons in the Art Institute's collection. But we looked at one in 2012. And it was a landscape subject, it wasn't an urban subject, and we were very tempted by it. Remember that, Julie?
Yeah.
Do you remember the price? It was a crazy thing. I mean, was it a pastel?
Mm-hmm.
It was a pastel, and it was a landscape painting, and it was about this big. We brought it here, we hung it in the Nixon, didn't we?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we hung it in the Nixon for a while, and we were really tempted by it, and the price, the price was something like $300, $400?
I think it was $375.
$375,000.
Oh,
not $375. We don't have those conversations.
Yeah.
Well, we do, but we don't share it publicly. Anyway, it was $375,000. And then
another one that was very much, very similar to, sold at auction for like 700, 600, something like that. And so we had to send an approval for 375, let's say. And we're very, you know, we were very tempted to buy it, but we also by that time had a beautiful shotgun mule blanche, Portrait of Baby Pinion Arizarese, that is one of the stars of our current exhibition. And that, and we'd already kind of fallen in love with that, and we couldn't buy Moe.
Yeah.
We didn't have enough money to buy Moe. So we waved goodbye to the Kaibon, and no one was happier about that than the dealer who had it with us on approval, because, you know, I guarantee you the next person he offered it to, he didn't offer it for $375. So this is one of my favorite paintings. You know, I mean, you don't really, I don't really associate Pizarro with painting ornamental gardens very much, in part because he hardly ever does. But he painted this one, and I struggle with the name. It's an estate called La Mathurin, and it was owned by a political activist and feminist writer and author named Marie Durand, and that's her right there, and she's in her garden kind of gazing at this, reflecting ball or whatever you call it, and Pizarro, you know, as you recall from probably our previous conversations, was absolutely a political, he was way on the left, he was a communist and an anarchist, and he had very, very radical political views, and so does she, even though she lives in this. You know, it's not so hard to be radical, but, you know what I mean. And so this is one of the rare paintings by Pizarro up in Ornamental Garden. And this painting is in the Nelson Atkins in Kansas City, and I lived in Kansas City for a few years, and so I see this painting all the time, and I just kind of love it. You know, it feels like Pizarro, in a slightly less agitated mood. But what have we got here? I thought when I blew this up, this might, these are poplar trees. I don't know what this is, and I'm not quite sure. I'm trying to look at this stuff through a magnifying glass, but I just couldn't figure it out. Maybe Magellan's again. I mean, that seems like a pretty good guess. Like I said, I really did intend to learn something about gardens and plants and things that, you know, that were cultivated in this moment. Maybe I'll do this again sometime. And so this is more the garden that you see in Pizarro painting. And this is Pizarro painting his own garden. What Caillebotte called the kitchen garden. This was the Pizarros, who were beastly poor. You know, as I've said many times, Pizarro was an artist. He struggled. He made wonderful paintings, but he struggled financially. He was one of the last ones to actually achieve a tiny measure of financial success. He has a bunch of kids. I mean, 6, 8 kids. Every last one of them becomes an artist. You know, do me a favor. Why don't you go to medical school? So, at this point, Pizarro is starting to have trouble with his, I believe it's his right eye, where he has these repeated infections that occur every time he goes outdoors, and for a landscape painter, that's really a problem. And so he winds up, and so we begin to see, starting in the late 1880s, more paintings of a higher vantage point. Now, why is that? Why would that be? Yeah, he's inside. He's looking out the window of his house. This is his studio over here. This is where he typically be painting, but now he's in his house, looking down on his own garden. And I've always been partial to this painting, and this little orchard. I mean, I know an orchard. orchard is not the same thing as a garden, but you know, they're not as similar. And I like this painting because I like this painting, which is ours. And the Dixon owns this painting, and it's, you're looking at this one lone tree. So he's painting this in 1894. This is a good 6 years later. He's still looking. I mean, he's still, this is, and even has, I mean, he's still painting indoors, and he'll do this again and again wherever he is, you know, whether he's, you know, he rents studios on upper floors in Paris as well. He rents hotel rooms in the Hotel Louvre, and looks down on the Place d'Opéra in Paris, one of my favorite spots in the city of Paris. So, not exactly an art. And then another artist that you don't necessarily associate with painting outdoors or painting gardens is Mary Brisson, but she does it there. She does it more than that. This is just a sweet little oil sketch. When I did the Brisson retrospective in 1998, this painting is, you know, about this big, maybe 14 inches wide and 12 inches tall. I mean, it's not a major work at all. And we have no idea who the sitter is. You know, those aren't Mary Cassatt's children. She didn't have children. She has children, but she doesn't. And so we have no idea who these people are, or even when it was. And we know it's, you know, like I said, it's probably made one sitting, very rapidly, but it's just so good. You know, it's so fresh, and the paint's hanging so nicely. I mean, she has a bit of, you know, she doesn't always bring it out, but she has a bit of Monet's dash or Renoir's dash. And then at a certain moment, you know, she begins to paint, and it only lasts from about 1878 till about 1882. And most intensively in 1880, she paints her sister Lydia in the garden. And we know this is Lydia because that's Lydia's dog. You know, I mean, you couldn't really tell by this, but it's unmistakable. And I love the way, you know, she's sort of surrounded by this garden. This garden is actually kind of closing in all around her. That's a poppy, right? Carnation. Yeah. I think you're right. And, you know, and we don't, you know, she may be reading, she may be knitting, she could be doing anything. She seems to be looking down. But in many ways, you know, Lydia Cassatt was going to be Mary Cassatt's partner in life, really. They were going to live, you know, they were, now they were married. Mary Cassatt has just turned, you know, 35. Lydia is almost 40. You know, they have a fabulous apartment in Paris that people comment on when they see it, including May Alcott, Louisa May Alcott's sister, who was a painter, comes to the Cassatt sister's house and just gushes about it in a long letter to Louisa. But Lydia is diagnosed with Bright's disease in 1878, which is a very serious kidney ailment, completely incurable in the 19th century, and it's in effect a death sentence, and it's a slow, terrible death. Plus the treatments, you know, so she's sick as she can be, and you know, in the 19th century, they thought if you're sick, what you really need is a change in the air. And so they're constantly putting her on trains and hauling her all over France to go to one place to another, when she just feels miserable and wants to curl up in a ball and stay at home. The treatments are ghastly too. I mean, you know, they talk about it in their correspondence a lot, as you would. And so Cassatt goes from having never once painted Lydia, because she completely took her for granted. She was going to be this person to share expenses with my whole life and is my older sister.